okay? It's almost anything that can conduct electricity. The drain pipe on the corner of your house. The baseball backstop could be an antenna. But the true nature of an antenna that is useful provides that enhanced signal that you want. Okay, and for that, a copper wire is the best. Now, how big is it going to be? What kind of a shape will it have? That will depend on its frequency and wavelength. Now, I have two algebra people here who can figure this out. We'll call it wavelength L. They sometimes use lambda. And we'll call F frequency. We know that the speed of light is a constant, right? This is your clue. So if the length increases, the frequency goes down. And if the frequency goes very, very high, what does the length of the antenna do? It's almost like a musical instrument. Which makes a higher pitch tone, a trumpet or a tuba? Okay, so knowing that, you can consider an electrical wire as a kind of a tuning fork for electrons. And when those electrons slosh back and forth, a moving charge, as you may know from physics, creates an electric field and a magnetic field. And the changing electric and magnetic fields going through the air make your radio wave. And when that radio wave goes out at the speed of light, this was discovered by James Clerk Maxwell in the 1860s. He worked from scientists previous to him, like Coulomb and Faraday, Ørsted, and was the ampere, where you get the ampere from, you know, way to flow over. Okay. These gentlemen did a lot of basic research, and Clerk Maxwell was a brilliant physicist, and he was almost the 19th century Einstein because he unified electricity and magnetism. His equations gave rise to knowledge of the speed of light, which had been measured. What is the speed of light? Okay, speed of light is about 300 million meters per second, or since we use the old Christian miles, 186,282.4 miles in 1 second. Notice that the meters is an actual number, 299,792,458 meters. Why? Because that's an international standard, so it comes out to a whole number. That's physics. So, an antenna is a wire. Or, very often, two wires. But if you have two wires, and the current is going in one direction, like this, an oscillating current, remember, every time your electrons speed up or slow down, you get an electric field or magnetic field. They'll cancel each other out. But if you turn them into a dipole, look what happens. It's going this way, and this way, and this one's going this way, and down this way, and it goes back and forth. But look, these are going in the same direction. And you know, did you ever do this experiment in school? Put a wire across a compass? Excuse me. And when you put turn through the wire, the compass needle goes. Have you done that experiment yet?
Oh, we have.
What's become a physics these days? When you have a nice current going in one direction, you get an electric field at the end and collapsing and expanding magnetic field. And that's what this simple antenna is right over here. A dipole, di for two, and two poles. And here it is. As my lovely assistant helps me, thank you. This is the shorter one. This is the driven element. And this is the reflector. There should be a director over here, but truth, full disclosure, I had a terrible time making an official antenna with that director location. So I only have the two. Excuse me. I don't have water. I forgot to bring it. So we know now what an antenna is. It's a conductor. Why do we need an antenna? Because we need a strong signal going into our radios for detection of the information that's there. Voice, data, okay? We're surrounded by data. You can see the Wi-Fi over there. The electromagnetic spectrum is rather wide, and it goes from very low frequency radio waves through AM broadcasting, FM radio. You guys, you're ultra-modern guys. You don't listen to AM radio. Remember when Top 40 was on AM radio? It doesn't happen anymore. Okay, so you listen to FM radio in the car. Okay, so that's about 80 megahertz to 100 amps. 88 to 100. So I used a term there, hertz. Why do we use the term hertz for cycles per second, which it was when you and I went to school? Heinrich Hertz was the discoverer. He implemented experiments that showed that Maxwell's equations actually worked in the physical world. In other words, he created a spark over here and a loop of wire over here with a small gap. And when he hit the button over there for the spark to go, a spark appeared over here. No connection. And it is kind of magic when you consider that an antenna will resonate or strongly respond to a certain frequency. And every ham knows this this formula. And you can impress your teachers if you know this. The wavelength of an electromagnetic wave in megahertz is 300 over the value. So, would be the wavelength of a 150 megahertz signal? 300 over 150?
Sure.
2 meters. That's the full wavelength. That might not be practical to have an antenna that's 2 meters tall. You can have a half wave, which is this, half wave dipole, made of 2/4. You can also have a quarter wave antenna with a virtual antenna underneath it. In other words, you have a conductive surface, it could be salty marshland, it could be the roof of your car, but if you have a conductive surface, anywhere where electrons are free to move around, and it's kind of like a mad game of musical chairs, they don't actually flow through the wire like water, they kind of go, and they go, when you cut the power, they all stop, and when you reverse the power, they go like this, jumping back and forth, so quickly that your cell phone operates on what? 1800 megahertz? 2.4 gigahertz? That's a pretty high, that's really going fast. Which means, remember your formula, wavelength 300 over megahertz, if you have a 2.4 gigahertz, 2,400 megahertz, what does that make this value over here? Now, one of the things I like to point out that in the ancient days, since I'm such an old guy and I'm kind of a dinosaur, did you know that cell phones, and I mean really a long time ago, like in the 90s, used to have antennas? In fact, you used to have to pull out your antenna. You and I remember that. You had to pull out the antenna and dial. Now, of course, some of us go back to bag phones from Radio Shack, where it weighed 20 pounds and was on a sack and the phone. Okay, but cell phone antennas are now internal. And the reason I got this was to show you the various shapes, log periodic antennas, where the elements are actually connected with antennas. You see these everywhere, television antennas. You know, kind of looks like a bow tie in a chicken cage. And what else? Helical antennas. Why? Because an electromagnetic wave is polarized. We usually call it vertically polarized if the electric field is going like this. And the magnetic field is always perpendicular to it. And the motion is perpendicular to both of them. So electric, magnetic, and the motion. And if you try to visualize a changing magnetic field causing a changing electric field, it's kind of like it's going through space like two slithering needles. So, what do you get? You know the speed of light is a constant, the speed limit of the universe, and our corresponds to the product of wavelength and frequency. And you can figure out the wavelength easily enough in meters, 300 over the water. Okay, so where are the antennas in our lives? Cell phone antennas, we've all seen those. Antennas sticking out of cars all over the place. Television antennas that look like aluminum Christmas trees that went over on their side. That you see those, not too much over the air television anymore. People like to get cable or what's another? Satellite. That where you have a geostationary satellite sending down, I don't know what, 20, something like that. And it comes down because the rotation of the Earth and the orbit of the satellite are the same at that distance, 22,000 miles out. It seems to stay in the same spot in the sky. I wish we had a ham satellite like that. So your antenna can remain fixed on the ground, and you need a dish, in other words, a parabolic reflector, a curved surface to concentrate these radio waves to, and what would it be? It might be just a simple pickle. It's only that big. There you are. And various types of antennas. For the ham bands, I have a ham band antenna right here. And I'm going to have to demonstrate, because we found to our dismay that this entire building is radio proof. I mean, I turned on the NOAA weather. It wouldn't even come through. NOAA weather would not come through on this transceiver. So that's why my lovely assistant is going to go over there.
Over there?
And the thing is, we built our antenna. How do we judge it? What number, what value, what formula will give us an idea whether or not this antenna is? I measured it. This is a half-wave dipole for it, the 2-meter ham band, 144 to 148 megahertz. But how good is it? Well, we have a standing wave ratio meter. You might say, standing wave ratio. Have you seen that before somewhere? Standing waves. If you tie a rope to a post and wiggle it a certain way, sooner or later, those waves will seem to just go up and down, standing waves. Now, what happens here is when this radio frequency energy goes down, it doesn't all get radiated. Sometimes it bounces back, and at certain levels it can actually damage the final power amplifier of your transceiver, so we want to avoid that. So, we're going to turn it on and see what this antenna can do. And we're going to put it like that. The point, I'm not going to irradiate anyway. Okay, we'll turn this on. And we're going to transmit a brief signal and see what the standing wave ratio of this antenna is. Ready? And what do you see? 1.72. Anything under 2 is not too bad. Okay? But will it work? So will my lovely assistant take a transceiver? It's on 146.520 simplex. Go to the other side of the room. I will see if I can receive it. And give your call sign, darling. I don't get to call many hands darling. We are in a radio soundproof area. I mean, I can't even get the NOAA Weather Channel, which is 162 megahertz. It's a really strong thing. But try it again.
This is? You will qualify.
There you go. And that does simple antennas from a rather simple guy. And any questions? Sure.
Can you use the term radio soundproof?
Well, yeah.
I know what you mean. I need to understand.
Radio energy is just absorbed by these concrete and steel walls. I mean, it hits.
My cell phone. She did her cell phone on Facebook. Her mother's watching the show on the phone. On hotspot.
But you're going over Wi-Fi. You're not doing 4G directly out, are you?
Going over hotspot.
Oh, you've got a hotspot. Must be nice.
No, the different you have brought it up. The difference is the wavelength.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Are you at 5 gigahertz or 2.4?
Your cell phone stuff is
2.4. Yeah.
Some of the stuff is 5.8. Mm-hmm. So that antenna must be this big.
That's amazing.
So when you're using this other
very stuff, often UHF will penetrate.
When you want this other stuff, then you're not going to use it.
So, any other questions? Why would we need a directional antenna? That one is somewhat directional. You saw some of these incredible, something like this, highly directional, more directors you have, you know. You can't get something for nothing. Yes, the antenna will radiate, but what you're doing is you're squeezing that radio energy into a long beam. And you still have losses, but in the direction that you're transmitting, the power is enhanced. Thank you, dear. Appreciate that. No other questions?
Directional antenna. Directional antenna are also.
Oh yes, they can. So when you go to a ham fest and they're doing 10 gigahertz and you see one of those dishes, don't stand in front of it. We don't want your coat.
There are three levels of ham radio licenses, right? And I talked about it earlier, right? Because there was a technician, there was a general, and there was the extra. And we talked about, you know, we kind of make jokes about it, but it's, you know, the technician license to learn not to hurt yourself, okay? The general license, you learn not to hurt